It's time for news from around the world. And meanwhile, in meanwhile, in Afghanistan, the Taliban said that things would be different, but will they? Because according to reports, they've been beating Afghans just for wearing Western clothes. A group of young Afghan men claim that Taliban fighters beat, whipped, and threatened them at gunpoint for wearing jeans and other Western style clothes in Kabul. The young men said the insurgents accused them of disrespecting Islam with their clothing choices. A reporter with Afghan newspaper Atila Atraz also said he was beaten over the weekend for not wearing Afghan clothes. And even US Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin admitted there have been incidents of people, you know, having some tough encounters with Taliban. So it probably takes a lot for the Secretary of Defense, who wants to paint a rosy picture of things, to admit that there have been tough encounters. Being beaten by a bunch of guys with assault rifles seems to strain the word tough, but anyway, Bridget, like I said, we'd been told they would be different, but so far doesn't seem super different.
No, it's of course not. I mean, I don't know why we're taking the Taliban's word for what they're going to do. I think we have a pretty good understanding of what happens when we do that. And I think, you know, we need to be clear about the role that the United States foreign policy has played in the destabilization of this area and what it means for the citizens there. So it's pretty heartbreaking. I hate to read these reports, but I can't say I'm entirely surprised that this is where we are.
Yeah, 100%. According to the Taliban, they say they're still determining a dress code. They don't know for sure. Okay, I'm sure they have a committee talking about it. And meanwhile, the price of burqas has apparently doubled in Kabul as people buy them in expectation of some sort of dress code. I read one source said up to 10 times as expensive as they normally would be. So again, we'll have to see. We'll be watching for this. My fingers crossed. I desperately hope that in every way that is possible, the lives of the people who will remain in Afghanistan are better than they were the last time the Taliban was in control, but so far signs aren't great. But that said, I do want to give some credit where credit is due, understanding all of our past criticisms. But according to the White House, they've announced that nearly 22,000 people were evacuated from Kabul in a period of just 24 hours, by far the highest one-day total so far. That's nearly double the 10,900 who were evacuated in the previous 24-hour period, and quadruple the number from the 24 hours before that. So they are ramping up very quickly, doubling every day, every 2 days. I doubt they'll continue that, but CNN anchor John Berman noted Tuesday morning it was all without a single US casualty, which is good. When you have to preface it with US casualty, that implies that other people are still at risk and are still suffering and still potentially dying. But they are, at the very least, they seem to have taken seriously, Bridget, the criticism that they weren't evacuating people who are vulnerable fast enough. And so far, it looks like they are doing much better.
Yeah, I'm happy to see that they're doing better. You know, I wish they had had a plan in place in the beginning of this where folks could be safely gotten out of there, you know, and not have to deal with this kind of chaos and, you know, instability just to keep themselves safe. And yeah, I'm happy to see that it seems to be going a little better now. But imagine if they had actually put a plan together before pulling out.
100%. Well, actually, let's demonstrate how little of a plan there was. So since August 14th, the US has evacuated and facilitated the evacuation of approximately 58,700 people, which is impressive. Since the end of July, we, the White House, have relocated approximately 63,900, which if you do a little bit of quick math, that means that in those first 2 weeks of August, basically nobody, almost nothing, like a couple of hours of yesterday's evacuation. So again, credit where credit is due. They were criticized for not people getting people out fast enough. They are now doing that. But how far will they go? Will they be constrained by this August 31st deadline that the Taliban says they're not allowed to break? When they say that they're gonna be getting out people who are vulnerable, I feel like there's always an unstated people who are vulnerable who helped the occupation. Whereas I'm interested in getting out people who are vulnerable, but let's keep it real. That's virtually every single person in Afghanistan is vulnerable when the Taliban are in power. So they're doing better in the specific task they were criticized on, but it very much remains to be seen how much better they're gonna do when it comes to actually protecting people who could be victimized or potentially murdered by the Taliban. Yeah. I want to play one last video, by the way, really fast. This is a little bit scary, but this is a spokesman for the Taliban. Here is what he had to say recently.
They can take all people, they can evacuate all people, but we will not allow Afghans to leave, and we want to extend that deadline. We will decide on this date later.
Okay. So for now, they're okay with us getting some people out, but we have to stop on the 31st, and they won't let Afghans leave after that. So sort of fundamentally, not a good sign for your government, your way of governing, if you have to bar people from fleeing your country. That's, I think, a fair rule, Bridget. What do you think?
Yeah, it seems like a really scary harbinger of things to come.
Mm-hmm. It does. Okay, so. Meanwhile, in meanwhile, in India, they have unveiled their first experimental smog tower at a cost of $2 million. That's intended to fight against the out of control pollution there, although it has its critics as well. You're seeing a photo of the smog tower. We also have a diagram that was provided of how big it is and how it's supposed to work. So what is the basic idea? Well, it uses 40 giant fans and 5,000 filters. It's an 82-foot tower that sucks in polluted air from the top, filters it, and then pumps it out from the bottom. According to the Indian Express, the tower covers a radius of about half a mile and filters about 35,000 cubic feet of air a second. Now, why is this necessary? Well, the city's chief minister called New Delhi a gas chamber back in 2019 due to the overwhelming population or pollution there. But air pollution continues to be a major problem across most of India. A study back in The Lancet in 2020 found that 1.67 million deaths were attributable to air pollution just in 2019. And New Delhi in particular has been the world's most polluted capital for the last 3 years. New Delhi air regularly exceeds, there's a measure of fine particulate matter that can inflame the lungs and cause respiratory illness. It exceeds the safe levels by up to 20 times. And experts have said that the city would need at least 213 of those smog towers to help resolve the pollution issue. So far, they have this one. They're gonna be leaving it up for 2 years to determine its effectiveness. We'll get to the other side of this, but it's an interesting technology. I mean, we've seen those on small scales for like living rooms. I haven't seen something like that for a city, Bridget.
Yeah, I mean, I'm no scientist, but part of me wants to say like, oh, I'm happy they're doing something. But if it really will take that many of them to make any kind of impact and they're that expensive, I guess I'm curious to see what kind of impact it could make, question mark. But clearly something needs to be done. So I'm not, you know, I'm happy they're thinking big and sort of thinking about new technologies that maybe can help.
Yeah. Yeah, I also am very much not a scientist, not a tech expert. Maybe this could show up on an episode of your podcast at some point, perhaps. But it also does have its critics. So critics have maligned the smog towers as a costly distraction from what they say is the real solution, which is actually curbing the emissions that are causing the pollution in the first place. So that's one problem. It's that, well, you're not fundamentally solving the problem, you're just mitigating it a little bit and potentially at a very high cost, both initially to set them up and then the maintenance that they would require. The other criticism though is that it might not work anyway. So there's an executive director of research and advocacy at the Center for Science and Environment said, we haven't come across any clear data that has shown that smog towers have helped to improve the outdoor ambient air quality of a city, either in India or other parts of the world. How do you filter air in a dynamic scenario when it's not in a confined area? They'd previously sort of tested it in artificial environments. So will it actually even work? Now, it's obviously a mixed thing. Like, I worry that a society that would spend the money on these smog towers would be less likely to actually resolve the issue that is generating the pollution. But if you live in a society that's not regulating the pollution, you kind of desperately need the smog towers. And we can apply the same sort of thing to our own pollution issues, to things like plastic waste, to our own carbon emissions, for instance. We kind of need to be doing both, and we desperately need to be doing the mitigation if we're not gonna be doing the regulation that caused it in the first place. But it's, I get the worry about how they interplay, Bridget, and what the sort of incentives might be when you set up systems like this.
Oh, absolutely. I think that's a problem that we really see when we're talking about climate injustice. all of these ways of mitigating and then having the mitigation, which, as you said, is necessary, take the focus off of the actual policy decisions that need to get made in order to get a handle on the issue. And so I'm always a big proponent of both, that you need that mitigation if you're not gonna, you know, meaningfully address the policy and things like that that will actually help, so that you're not just trying to do what you can after the fact. But I think in this case, it does need to be like a two-pronged attack.
Check out the Damage Report podcast each day, wherever you get your podcasts, whether Pocket Casts or Stitcher or iTunes. You can join me as I give you the news and stories you want, with a range of co-hosts and interview guests jumping in on the fun each day. Again, that's the Damage Report, wherever you get your podcasts. And if you get them at iTunes, don't forget to rate and review. Sometimes I'll read them live on the show.